So would you advise like couples to have, couples that don't have planners, or even the ones that have planners, you suggest that they have lawyers read through their
contract? I actually 100% believe that, yes. So like, it depends on how you want to move here. Obviously, I can't just tell everybody to go and spend all that money. Maybe they're not even spending, maybe they're not even spending half of that on the wedding in itself, and then all of a sudden they're spending.
Get a lawyer to do this.
But contracts are a grown man business. Contracts are big boy business.
They are.
And the reason why I say that is because you want to make sure that you completely understand what you're signing in before you do it. So if there's any doubt at all, ask for clarification. And if there's still doubt, then please consult an attorney, because you don't want to get yourself into something that you do not,
don't understand, or you can't get out of. Mm-hmm. So is that a service that you offer?
Well, see, that's the thing. I mean, my service is really mostly geared to event professionals.
Event pros, okay.
So from that end, you always hear that. But like, I'm always happy to, like, you know, obviously do a quick review and sign off on like an agreement and make sure that the person is being protected.
Or at least they're considering everything that they should be considering in the contract.
Yes, exactly. So we can do that. And I actually definitely do that. So we'll just go over it and, like, you know, we book a maybe 1 hour session. And we
exactly. And just go over
what I'm explaining, what your status is or how you can proceed in there.
Right. Because some of these clauses, even I as an event planner, sometimes I'm like, what is this clause saying? Like, it doesn't, it's like saying nothing. Just like so vague that, you know, yeah. So, okay. And then you also said something like people skim through the contracts, and that is something you don't want to do. You want to read through each line.
Like, we skim on the terms of and conditions of a website.
Exactly. Right. That one.
Accept.
Accept. Like, I definitely do that all the time, because I'm like, I don't want to read all this. But yeah, it's so important to read every line of a contract. And that's part of like what your event planner would do. But if you don't have an event planner, you have to spend that time reading through each line so you understand. And that's something that I also had to like make sure I did, especially after 2020, because there's some vendors I work with all the time that I already know what their contract says and I can just like skim through because I kind of know. But after 2020, a lot of them have changed their contracts. So I had to like start reading through and figuring out, especially what they're saying with regards to cancellations and postponements. So say, for example, a couple's some contract or a vendor contract does not include cancellation and postponement clauses or terms or conditions or whatever. Should I require, as me as a bride now, I'm asking as a bride or a groom, should it be required to be included, or is it okay if I just like ask them in an email, or do I have to tell them to add it to the contract?
Request an amendment. I would always say that, request it. Like, don't never be hesitant. And this is not legal advice. I don't know everybody's specific claims. Have to say that so I do not get sued. But I think it's really important that you request an amendment and have it imbibed into the contract. So you're not now like, anything outside of the agreement, you want to be very clear that in writing it's going to be incorporated. So having it in an amendment, like an amendment to the agreement that includes that language, is really important. So it can be included in the original agreement. So that's something that you should always, before performance of the, like before the performance of, like, which is usually the event date, before the termination of the agreement, have that amendment put in there. And so that it can start moving on, like it can be included into the language of the agreement.
Okay, that makes sense. And then one other thing I wanted to touch on was COVID. So I wanted to ask if couples should consider having their guests sign, well, two part, guests, and then the other part is vendors, sign some kind of COVID clause for the event day. So like on the wedding day, like if anything happens to you, I'm not liable for...
Well,
So should they require vendors?
Okay. So the couples are responsible for their clients. And
regardless of if they...
Sorry, not clients. I keep saying clients. I apologize. But they're guests. Mm-hmm. But like they're responsible in that you're the host, technically. I mean, obviously there's conversation around, and the truth is this depends. My favorite lawyer statement to say, it depends.
You don't want to be held to anything.
And also because it depends by state, it depends by jurisdiction, it depends by situation. Okay. So there are many nuances there. Like, for instance, there are some states already, like there are actually a good number of states that already have this like assumption of risk liability waiver. Inherited in there. It's inherent in the like in their laws, basically stating that if you are partaking in an event that involves like face-to-face or like close contact, just like if you were going on a roller coaster, sometimes you will sign a waiver depending on anything. If you're participating in something of high risk. So in this situation where there is a communicable disease of no cure right now and of limited vaccine exposure at the moment. Mm-hmm. Like there's in a few states, there's already that discussion, like for instance, that there's an assumption of risk that you're participating with it.
Got it.
But if you're hosting it, you're the one that's bringing people into this space with the idea and the expectation that you're going to take the necessary precautions, then maybe you want to have them sign a liability waiver and then put it out there, like, you know what you're participating in. Mm-hmm. I mean, like I said before, contracts are receipts, like assumptions, like waivers and releases. Like it's proof that this person knew that they were participating in this. This person knew that there were going to be 100 people here. This person knew this. So the couple having them sign that is never a bad thing. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Like, never. At the worst, it's just a piece of paper. At the best, it could literally be protecting you from like random frivolous lawsuits when somebody... Yeah. Because when somebody catches COVID all of a sudden.
Exactly. And they want to come and sue you or something.
Yeah. And then in terms of the vendors are independent contractors. They're not employees of the of the couple. They're the ones that have been contracted here, but they're the ones that are choosing to do this. So it's important from the vendor aspect. Maybe they are the ones providing the couple with the liability waiver. Mm.
Yeah.
So let's make sure that everybody has this covered. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Also, because vendors also have responsibilities to their subcontractors. So people that are working for you there literally do not have a choice, but because of their employment, they are working there. Yeah. Not even necessarily subcontractors, but employees.
Right.
So like, because subcontractors technically would also be like, you know, they're coming here. But you want, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's from two different
angles. Yeah.
The couple is coming in from this side. But this is the reason why, for instance, people have an indemnification. This is the reason why an indemnification clause in your service contract for the vendors is really important, because you're telling the couple to hold you harmless for specific events or hold you harmless for things that happen.
So that is what an indemnification, like, in other words, indemnification clause.
Yeah, indemnification is like a must in your contract.
A must, because, guys. Indemnification
clause. Yeah. So check your indemnification clause, because it's a hold harmless clause. And it's basically saying that when somebody comes and sues me, don't bring me in, don't call me, because you call me, you've already signed this and I don't want to hear your rubbish. So like, it's something to also bear in mind when you're having that agreement, like, you know what I mean? But like, so I can't say, like, I get this question a lot about the liability waiver.
Yeah.
I can't say that it's useless or it's this or that, because the truth is that a lot of this stuff is new in terms of what's happening for a lot of us, including the lawyers and including the courts, in terms of how they're going to even start accepting or upholding certain things.
Yeah.
But at the worst case, it's a document. Mm-hmm. At the worst case, it's something where they can click and put their name and approve if you're going to do it virtually or whatever. Right. But at the best case, it could literally be a good protection. So why not?
Okay. All right. I like that.
Thank and you. There's a COVID-19 liability waiver on Legally Set. So if you
there COVID, is, guys. So make sure, is that for, who's that for? Is that for pros, or that can even be used by brides and grooms as well?
Yeah, the bride and couple can also, they can definitely repurpose it and then use it. There's one for service providers, there's one for venues. Like, okay, if you're looking for a good COVID-19 liability waiver.
Oh, nice. I will link it in the description of this video, so you guys check it out and make sure you read through it. So read through every line of your contract, make sure you understand everything that it's saying. Be very specific with like reading through cancellation, postponement, type thing. And if you need a lawyer to read through it, you can call Kumbi or call somebody else.
Yeah, or call somebody in your jurisdiction.
Okay, because you're also like limited to New York, but you can still kind of read through it and know like in general what should or shouldn't be included.
Well, I mean, there's general conversation in terms of like consultation or advising, right, but in terms of legal services, I can't provide legal services to anybody that's outside of like, jurisdictions that I'm admitted. I'm admitted in New York, I'm admitted in Pennsylvania, and DC is pending.
Oh, DC, yay! That's awesome. Okay, good. All right, so this would be like the last kind of question, but what are some very important things, and this is not just specific to COVID, but what are some general things that should be in every contract? And I know that couples deal with photographer, DJ, blah, blah, blah.
Oh, yeah.
What are some general things that people should make sure that are in every, you have it in every contract?
Okay. So for sure, like definitely from the beginning, it's even just clarifying who's entering the contract. So if it's the couple together, make sure that it's language that it's a couple individually together. Because I know that a lot of times, like...
Question. Mm-hmm. Before you continue.
I feel like it's the same question.
Okay, finish.
Because then a lot of times parents pay for... Oh, yeah. So like, I mean, it could be one or the other. Like, it could be one or the other. But the person that is contracting in that contract is the person that is receiving the services and the person that has any claim in that agreement. So if it's both of them, then, like, I mean, obviously on the vendor's aspect, you want to make sure that it's both of them so that they're jointly, like, in there together.
Just in case. Yeah.
Just in case one of them decides to just go silent. But then in other cases, like, for instance, like, when the couple's parents pay for the agreement, I always recommend, like, obviously, have the couple sign the agreement, but then include a third party payer addendum to your agreement. So that part is just stating that you're the one that is financially liable for this. So if I'm coming for you, I'm coming for you. But this is where the beginning and end of your participation in that aspect of the agreement, so that you don't have to now be answering to three, like, you know, different. Where the mother of the bride is now calling and telling you that she's the one paying, so she can't talk to you anyhow. You want to make sure, like, it's clear that this is the limited service part of the agreement. But in the event that somebody does not pay, I'm coming for you.
Okay.
And you are still a financially responsible party in this agreement. So having that, so in terms of the couple looking and making sure that you understand who the parties of the agreement are, it's also great to also make sure that you know who is entering the agreement. Mm-hmm. Like if you're the couple and looking into the thing, like, check out the entity that is entering. Is it a legal entity? If it's a legal entity, if it's an individual, then you know, so that you don't want a situation where you don't know who to
go after. So let me ask you this. Now that you mentioned that, I'm sorry to cut you off. I want to forget. If you hire, let's say you hired like a photography company, mm-hmm. and they have different photographers that could provide that service.
Yeah. I mean,
should you ask them to specifically identify in the contract who in that photography company is going to be your wedding photographer, or it's okay to just have the general name of the contract of the company?
This is asking from the couple side, because I would say for the vendors,
yeah, from the couple,
have the company there, because then
you can pick whoever.
Yeah, like in the event that you're not able to perform, then somebody at least in your company is able to perform those services and you're not in breach. But if you're the couple, for instance, and if it's something where you guys have already, like during the discussion, it's very clear that you have a preference, this is the person that has agreed to come, then you might want to look into your agreement and make sure that is specified that this person is going to be providing this service. Okay. So that on that day, when the person sends their assistants, you're like, oh, wait a minute. But you told me that this is who was going to be providing the service. Just like that is obviously from the couple's end.
Yeah.
In terms of like, so that's one thing. I think definitely the payment clause, like you and I have already spoken about, please make sure that it's very clear as to what language is there and what is non-refundable. Okay. What is non-refundable under any circumstance? So you know how much money is gone merely by booking this date. Go ahead.
I want to cut you off again. So based on the payment, this is, again, I'm just thinking from the bride and groom's perspective. Mm-hmm. Vendors usually have like different payment plans, right? Mm-hmm. You pay me $500 as a deposit and the rest of it is broken out, or you pay me 30% of the contract. Now, a lot of hesitation we've been getting from couples is like, because of COVID and because everything is so uncertain, should they, and maybe you alluded to this already, should they agree to, let's say a vendor says, you need to pay me 50% now and the remaining 50% before the wedding, because of everything happening and knowing that 50% might never be refunded to you, should the clients ask for a different payment plan and not commit to that? Like, how can you, I guess from the bride and groom's perspective, I'm trying to figure out how they can protect themselves from getting into such a huge amount, committing into a huge amount, and they have to move their wedding or cancel their wedding and they won't get that huge amount back.
That's the thing. Sorry, Lola.
No, go ahead. Yeah.
So I think that's part of the reason why I said it's always like, you know, like, I mean, never be afraid to negotiate the terms, especially if the vendor is willing. Like, I mean, this is a conversation about a long-term agreement, so you want to make sure that you're both protected. Yeah. I think that, like, obviously you will find pushback in that there's a fixed amount. Like, because you have to also remember that vendors are entering into these agreements now. Well, they're trying to accommodate your previous postponements or whatever, your new dates, as dates from this. And so like time in the calendar. And I think this is just speaking on their behalf here. It's like, you know, there's booking something in the calendar is going to be really difficult. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you bear in mind that in terms of the money that they're losing, it's basically clear, but it's not something that they can tell you. It's basically that I've prioritized you being here on this date because I'm letting somebody else
go.
So, yeah. I mean, that is just something to bear in mind. But in terms of like negotiating, then like, I know that a bunch of vendors now, and a lot of people argue with me now until tomorrow, to the point that even me, I'm starting to come to their side now in the discussion around monthly payment plans or some of their payment plans in some form. Mm-hmm. A lot of vendors are offering that. So maybe then you're breaking up the payments and discussing what is non-refundable upon incurring and things like that. Obviously, it's the more money on the vendor side that they have to be collecting every month, less like, the more money they have to keep policing to arrive. But on the other side, it's great for it's helped a lot of their clients and for a couple, peace of mind that you're not paying such a big block of money in advance or anything like that. You should make this, for instance, this conversation that we're having, this is something that you should look for in your venue agreements, because the idea is that venues are giving you their best and single asset, which is the provision of their building, of their space. Mm-hmm. So if by you entering this space, nobody else can enter this space. Mm. So for that, because of that, that's the reason why a lot of the times like the non-refundable number is high. It's usually like, you know, a high block of the fee because this is their biggest and bestest, for lack of, I don't know the word, asset. So they're providing it to you and they're performing by giving you that date. Mm-hmm. So it's stuff to bear in mind and stuff that you will see, but please never, ever be afraid to negotiate because everybody's trying to make it work during this time. You will find that a lot of things might be flexible in terms of maybe it is a smaller non-refundable retainer instead of like, you know, a bigger, a larger one. Maybe in exchange for a smaller non-refundable retainer, maybe the fee itself is a larger amount at the end of the day, or maybe like it's just, you know, like maybe that is now considered maybe like the full payment, but it's not like maybe a smaller percentage is non-refundable. There's a lot of give and take when it comes to these things. Like when you're like, weddings are expensive, so there's a lot of give and take in terms of the conversation. So please do not hesitate.
Don't hesitate. Okay. Okay. So please keep going. So you mentioned knowing the parties that are involved, and then
knowing the parties, the payment being clear. Payment terms need to be clear.
Very clear.
But most importantly, like, and this goes outside of weddings and like in any of your contracts, make sure that the statement, like the description of services and the statement of the services that will be performed is very clear. There's a lot of times that people are very generic, but then what happens is that you don't want to be that person that's overstepping your boundaries. Mm-hmm. You don't want to be the person that is adding stuff and like then you're creating a very hostile environment for you and the person that you're hiring. Yeah. But at the same time, you want to be clear about what the service they are saying that they're going to provide. Because then when the vendor starts to act funny and is not providing the things that they said they will provide, all of a sudden and telling you that they will charge an additional fee, you can show them and be like,
It's written down here.
It's written right here. So like this is probably going to be a make or break in terms of like a good description of services so that it's not left to interpretation as to what you're doing.
Yeah.
So if the person is providing event planning services, what does that entail? Like, what will they be doing? Is there going to be this? Is there going to be this communication with vendors? Like, let it be listed so that when you do it, and so that you're not that person that's asking your event planner to be your florist on the day of, or you're not that person that's asking your event planner to be your MC, or also the cleanup service, or before and after. It's exhausting for everybody.
Yeah, yeah. No, that makes sense. That is so key because, you should write it out because I've had, like, some cases where like, we agreed to doing this particular table arrangement with the florist. And then the florist only did one part of it, but it wasn't listed in the contract. The contract just said, I'm providing this centerpiece. It didn't
say providing
three instead of providing five, you know, so it's very important to be very
numbers, especially numbers. That is a very valid point. I'm sorry. My client was texting me, that's a very valid point. Like, description of services in that regard, we've only spoken about the planner or whatever, but how many pictures are you expecting from the
photographer?
How many what is thing, how many hours of coverage are you expecting?
Exactly.
Like, are they going to be coming with a second shooter? Because let me tell you something, there's nothing worse than a salty day when you realize that, okay, maybe the person didn't come with a second shooter, so they're only taking it from this perspective, but that could already have always been their own operation procedure. So how many photographers will they be providing on that day? How many assistants? How many hours, most importantly, will they be coming for? Three, have you given them, like, maybe they discussed with you, maybe they did provide you with a shortlist form and you never filled it out. Like, they might list it inside there and let you know that this is going to be provided based upon a shortlist or whatever. But also, like, now that you've mentioned it, like, you know, florist, but even with your event rentals, what exactly are you expecting? And when would the final inventory be provided so that you know what is coming? A description of services is crucial because then it sets expectations and it prevents disappointment.
Right.
So that is something that I'm literally on like the first four paragraphs of it. Like, I'm literally on the first page of the contract. So that's something like, and I'm not going to bore you guys with like the very, very like specific things, but that's something that you want to make sure that is very clear. Okay. And then obviously, like I mentioned before, the postponement, cancellation, is there any discussion of what constitutes breach of the contract, breach and termination? They might not look exactly like I'm calling them. They could be called date change, rescheduling, can be called termination, cancellation. There can be different forms.
Different names.
What is considered, like, what is expected of you as the client? Like, what is expected of you? Like, do you need to respond to things within a particular period of time? Like, if a vendor asks you for something, what's the time limit in which you have to respond? Do you have to, what happens if your payment fails? What happens if you, there's a late payment, is there a late payment fee? What kind of payment method is acceptable?
Accepted.
Are they accepting cash app or are they accepting Like, and I mean, like, it just, whatever is discussed there needs to be very clear.
Mm-hmm.
So like, these are clauses that have to be, then you now have to now start looking, like I said, indemnification clauses, like it's important. It seems like one of those clauses that you just add at the end, but it's really important. But most also, like, there's no most important. I keep saying most important.
They're all important.
They're all important. But like, also you should look out for a governing law or jurisdiction so that in the event that you have to sue or that you get sued, which state, especially since a lot of people deal with destination or like maybe they're bringing somebody from another state or whatever, you don't want to have to now go to another state to go and fight this person. So making it clear where the governing law is and the jurisdiction that will hold in your contract is also a very valid point to have there.
Okay.
Like I mentioned, force majeure, in the event that somebody is not able to perform the contract, one of the parties of the contract is not able to be there, is not able to do it because of something that has happened that is legally outside of their control, what happened?
Yeah.
Like, these are things that need to be in there. Like I said, these are just general across the board, regardless of any professional. Okay. But I would say that there are many.
There are a lot. And I feel like we still even need to break down each vendor's contract because each contract is like different. But we don't have all
very different
all your time before you start billing me for all these
hours. I was just about to look, right now I'm sending you my check.
Well, thank you so much. You hit so many key points. And I think, you know, just as you have said over and over again, is just to make sure that you understand your contracts and you read through every single detail and get help when you don't understand it and make sure you get clarification. And I guess as much detail as possible, nothing is too much to put into a contract, I guess, as far as what the person is providing. So be very specific as far as the description of the services and what they're providing.
Yeah.
All right.
That's exactly it.
Love it. Clarity is key. Yep, I agree. Thank you so much. Any final thoughts for brides and grooms before I ask you a few rapid fire questions?
No problem. So for me, I think it's just like, just make sure that your contract makes sense to you. Make sure that it makes sense to you. Don't just sign things. This is not the time. This is not the period for you to be entering into like risky contracts, a contract that you're not clear about. It's not good for you. It's not good for the vendor. And it's not good for your bottom line, which is your money. So like, you want to be clear. And it's also not good for your expectations. You don't want to be disappointed in your day. So make sure that you are checking these things and understanding the clauses in your contract, so there are no problems.
Yeah. Sorry. All right. Thank you so much. Love it. Love it. All right. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. So it's going to be very general. Some wedding related, some not. Not a lot.
Let's do it.
All right. So first one, would you rather book a hotel for your wedding or an event center? An event center meaning like not in a hotel, standalone hall, or would you book a hotel? Think like a lawyer.
Hotel for me, because I did book a hotel. And I like the idea of everybody just being in one place.
One place.
So like, that's why I wasn't sure. Yeah,
One-stop shop. Okay, all right. Would you rather do a destination wedding or local wedding? Local to your vicinity.
Destination.
You did destination too, so I guess that would be. Okay. This one is funny. Would you advise, I won't let it be personal to you, would you advise others to get a prenup or no prenup?
Well, I like prenup. I actually do like prenup. I like the idea of, I like everybody being clear from the beginning, like what's going to happen. So just bear that in mind. But if you feel like you have a lot to protect, or if you want to just make sure that the terms are clear, maybe, like, I mean, a prenuptial agreement is just a prenup. It doesn't necessarily mean that yours is yours, mine is mine. It just determines what will happen in
the event.
So the lawyer in my mind is just going to say that part.
Do prenup. Okay, so I heard of postnup recently. What exactly?
You can do that too. Like, you can create an agreement at any point.
At any point.
A prenup is obviously it's this thing, but I mean, a legal agreement is a legal agreement. So never be like, maybe if you hammer, I think it's just harder. Like if you get it big or something.
if I start making some money and I'm like, husband, sign this agreement, you'll be like, wait, what's going on?
That's the thing. So that's the same thing. It's even the same thing that can be applied to like even owning contracts now and things like that. Like even as a professional or an entrepreneur, whichever one you could be, like it's the same thing. Like it's harder to obviously sign, like have somebody sign a new contract when you're already within one contract. So it's up to you to decide. Do you want to take the risk? If you ain't got no money, is this a waste of time?
All right. And that just made me think of a question, but I'm going to ask it. We'll do part two. And I will do another session of this.
We'll do it.
Last question. Would you ask your bridesmaids to sign a contract or not?
It was jokes though.
You did?
But it was a joke, I promise, mostly.
What was in your contract? What was in the contract with them?
That they will still be my friend after this because I'm not crazy. Of course not. I did that and they're still my friends, so that's that.
Thank God.
But like, obviously not. Like, I think like if you're really trying to hold them to something, this is something that they're volunteering their time to. There's nothing
and money.
Mm-hmm. Like the whole idea of the contract is that one party is offering something in response to another. There has to be consideration of some sort. Like, so somebody needs to be offering something in response, if it's money or not. Like, right. Chances are, if they are doing you this, especially as a volunteer service, they ain't getting SHIT.
But so they're getting publicity.
Then in that case, then it's a vendor relationship. To enter into that vendor agreement. What?
I know some brides are like, wait, I need them to sign that they're not going to get pregnant, that they're not going to gain weight.
What is the consideration for this? Like, what is it that they're getting in exchange for it? So chances are they will whoop your ass in court if you try to enforce that, is what I'm telling you.
I love it. Thank you so much, Kumbi. This was amazing.
Thank you for having me.
And hopefully everyone got something. What are you drinking?
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it, sweetheart.
Hopefully all our brides and grooms got something really good from this, you know, what to look out for when you're getting those vendor contracts, especially in 2021. Like, things have changed with COVID, so please read through all your contracts and read every line and get clarification. All righty, until next time, thanks guys, thanks Kumbi,
thanks for having me.
Bye.